Welcome to Quality Improvement, HIT Implementation Planning for Quality and Safety. This is Lecture B. The focus of this lecture is on providing you with effective go-live support strategies. The objectives for HIT Implementation Planning for Quality and Safety are to assess the quality implications of Big Bang versus staggered approaches to activation. Discuss go-live support strategies that minimize risk. And discuss post-live maintenance support strategies. There is debate about whether it is better to take the Big Bang approach or to use a staged approach to introduce new technology and processes. When we speak about the Big Bang theory with respect to IT, we are not talking about the television sitcom or the scientific theory on the origins of the universe. Rather, we are discussing an approach to implementation of the electronic health record. With the Big Bang IT strategy, the goal is to get it over with quickly. Small practices have the best odds of succeeding with the Big Bang approach. The Big Bang approach can be appealing because, while quite intense, it is short and calls for the organization's energies and resources to be almost completely focused on the implementation of the EHR. This strategy minimizes long-term resource shortages and compresses the pain and difficulty of an IT project into a shorter period of time. Unlike a phased approach that unfolds over time, some initiatives require a Big Bang approach, a case in point being when a country decides to change from driving on the right-hand side of the road to the left-hand side of the road. This is not the time for a phased approach. A clean, cut-to-the-new way of doing via a Big Bang technique has its benefits. The downside of the Big Bang implementation approach is that it is stressful, requires a great deal of pre-planning so that details are not overlooked, and contingency plans are solid. Changes to processes can have far-reaching consequences, some of which are not evidenced until some time has passed. Therefore, a Big Bang approach can result in unexpected sequelae that may have a negative impact on the organization and the patient population. This type of strategy is inherently risky due to the potentially catastrophic consequences of a single flaw in the way the software has been configured, or in the way processes have been re-engineered. In addition, it does not allow for problem identification and resolution to occur on a small scale, but rather, when problems arise, they affect all users. On the other end of the spectrum is the phased approach, which is slower and staggered over time. Teams that use this approach transition to the new EHR incrementally in a carefully staged approach. Larger practices and practices with multiple locations may benefit from this approach. This strategy allows project teams to continue with day-to-day operations while devoting more time in planning, customizing, and then pilot testing the new system. It also allows teams to stage the implementation to be consistent with clinical demands or workflow. The downside of this approach is that it often lacks the urgency and focus of a Big Bang project. It can also lead to change fatigue on the part of both the users and the project team. In comparing the two approaches, one can readily see the differences. The Big Bang approach is fast, so anxiety is short-lived, and you have the potential to have a quicker realization of return on investment. The implementation is accomplished in a shorter time frame, so you are able to maintain momentum. You don't need to worry about the problems that having to use a hybrid paper and electronic systems presents. At the same time, there is higher risk, higher anxiety, larger scope, and the need for greater numbers of resources for training and implementation support. With incremental strategies, problems are less likely to erupt. There is less anxiety and greater ability to manage implementation of incremental units. At the same time, the implementation is slower. It takes longer to see the return on investment. There are higher training costs, and there is the potential for stagnation. The contextual implementation model, or CIM, is a way of examining how one should approach HIT implementations. Given that such implementations are ongoing and iterative, it is important to take into consideration three contextual levels of differences. These include organizational, clinical unit, and individual contextual differences. Before implementing an EHR, the implementation team should thoroughly analyze the context at organizational, departmental, and individual levels, which might have an impact on clinicians' use of the system. When analyzing the context at the organizational levels, implementation teams should look at the organizational culture, available resources, the experience the organization has with IT implementations, size and location of the organization, where they are in the implementation lifecycle, the organization's mission and strategic plan, and where IT fits into that vision, existing structures and policies at the organizational level as these relate to the use of HIT, the roles of doctors and nurses in the organization, as well as the organization's leadership. Then the implementation team should analyze work practices at the clinical unit level. They should assess the culture of the team, the engagement level of unit leadership, any experiences the unit may have had with IT, the clinical profile of the unit, its size, and user attitudes related to use of IT. Differences in these areas can then be planned for and included in the implementation project plan. Finally, the implementation team should look at the diverse ways of working, thinking, communicating, and collaborating of individual users, as well as their computer literacy and keyboard skills. During implementation, the implementation team should focus on contextual differences at individual and clinical unit levels, and how these differences could be accommodated within the use of the information system. This requires detailed analysis of the functionality of the system and how different clinicians' needs could be accommodated. Computer literacy and keyboard skills would require targeted training programs. Team cultures that are constructive and supportive of innovations should be a goal. Implementation teams should devise strategies to modify team cultures to ones that are receptive to change and supportive of the change process. Interventions can be devised to improve information sharing amongst team members, encourage support for innovation, provide a clear vision and objectives for staff, and thus promote a constructive culture that is receptive to innovations. Implementation of HIT represents a major transformation of care in increasingly complex healthcare systems. There are three principles that are important to keep in mind. First, diverse interactions and self-organization are critical to success. The more we can involve clinical users in the implementation planning, the greater the chance for success. Diverse interactions create more options for action. Second, complex adaptive systems cannot be highly efficient and continue to survive in the dynamic environments that characterize these continually learning and adapting systems. Leaders must expect a certain level of noise, creativity, and exploration. Finally, effective structures are the key to system behavior. The more complex the site, the greater the need for structures to ensure success. Banner Health, a large complex healthcare system in Arizona, has provided us with keys to successful system-wide implementation of IT. They have defined a structure that includes a strategic system oversight team with senior leadership members, a centralized leadership model with matrix reporting, multiple nested content and process expert teams, and network layers for rapid design and redesign, hospital oversight teams with the executive leader sponsors, project management teams for each application implementation, and centralized trainers to deliver consistent training content at the facility level. Let's take a closer look at the nested teams and networks that they have created. There are operational teams, which are standing committees made up of individuals from across the health system who represent specific services areas, such as critical care or preoperative areas. These teams are responsible for standardizing operational processes and patient safety practices. Then there are a number of clinical discipline teams, such as nursing, physicians, and social workers. These teams are made up of members of a single discipline, and they are responsible for ensuring that professional practice standards are defined and addressed. Next, there are the multidisciplinary clinical consensus teams that develop practice standards related to specific patient populations or problems. Finally, there are problem-oriented ad hoc teams. These are short-lived teams that are formed to provide rapid action solutions for specific problems or interests. There are many ways in which implementation support can be crafted. For smaller organizations, most software vendors either provide or can recommend external consultants to assist with implementation support or training support. Larger organizations generally find that it is better to cultivate internal consultants. You will find a variety of names and roles for these internal support people, such as super users, coaches, or mentors. They can also be informally organized or can be a part of a more formal support pool structures. Many organizations rely on external consultants to provide training and go-live support. These individuals have expertise in use of the particular software application being implemented, are experienced in implementing that system in a wide variety of settings, and have the dedicated time to support the implementation. The downside of using external consultants is their lack of familiarity with specific organizational policies and workflows, and the fact that this option is usually more costly than using internal personnel. Clinical personnel, usually nurses, who have training and knowledge beyond the usual end user for the given software application, can be very valuable as a support for system implementation. These clinicians serve as bridgers or links between the clinical world and the IT world. They have a deep understanding of clinical workflows, since this is the world in which they live and provide care. They have credibility with other users, since they understand the problems that users face in the clinical environment, and they can help translate the needs of the end user to the IT technical teams. These internal experts are called a variety of names, depending on the particular role that they play in their organizations. These roles may be informal or formal. Internal consultants are drawn from bedside users to assist with training and implementation, and many of them have ongoing roles well beyond system implementation. Most often, their primary responsibilities include serving as champions and promoting IT adoption, assisting with and reinforcing training, assisting with policy and procedure development, and serving as liaisons between clinical and IT personnel. In some instances, their roles extend to ongoing competency testing and quality oversight of use of the EHR. Gruber and colleagues conducted a systematic literature review on factors that influence the outcomes of HIT implementation and reached the following conclusions. First, it is not possible to designate a single implementation strategy that works in all settings. Next, quote, the highest number of factors influencing success or failure was reported during implementation and system go-live. End user support, or lack thereof, was a significant factor in both successful and failed implementations. End quote. Finally, long-term attention to end user training and support is the key to data quality. Andre and colleagues conducted a qualitative study of EHR implementation in palliative care settings and reported that all the respondents wanted a resource person. The expectations regarding this person differed. This person had to be present on the unit to provide at-the-elbow support. The person should be able to provide quick help and should be a driving force. This person should also be responsible for training and teaching. They concluded that for implementations to be successful, there is a need for skilled and motivated key personnel. A formal plan for post-implementation support and ongoing training should be implemented as soon as the system goes live. This often involves software vendor support and regular upgrades once the initial software is installed and functional. This concludes Lecture B of HIT Implementation Planning for Quality and Safety. In summary, there is no single best way to implement HIT. Organizational, clinical unit, and individual contextual factors are important for HIT implementation planning. End-user education and support is critical to success. Long-term end-user training and support drive quality.